This is Wraith from Wraith Rain. I'm an author of serialized gay romance fiction. Every week on this podcast, I'll be reading a chapter from one of my gay fantasy shifter serials called Dragon's Reign. I'll explain at the break how you can find out more about this story and others I write. So let's get to it. Chapter 11, Stay or Go. Caden stopped dead in his tracks about 10 feet from the doors of the Dragon King's quarters. His mouth dropped open, and he gasped out, "I was going to talk about the President of the goddamn United States chasing us into your rooms. And then I saw your rooms. Holy shit, this is amazing!" Caden spun slowly in a circle. Valerius's rooms were the entire tower. The tower was hollowed out. A winding staircase made of stone curled around the outside walls to large platforms that jutted out from the tower. He craned his head back. On one of the platforms, he saw a gleaming open-air shower and a huge clawed tub. On another were racks and racks of clothes. Leather and silk were predominant. And at the very top was a massive four-poster bed with crimson curtains drawn back by golden ropes. On that platform, there was a huge, curved opening onto a balcony that extended far beyond the tower's edge. "That must be one of the places where he transforms and takes off from," Caden realized. Caden lowered his head and rubbed the back of it. He felt almost dizzy. The first floor was dominated by a circular fireplace surrounded by two half-moon-shaped couches heaped with furs and pillows that dominated the center of the tower. A fire was already crackling merrily inside. A large grate, similar to a barbecue grill grate, was over this fire. There were tongs and a scraper. "He cooks his own food on it?" Caden thought. "Huh. Who would have known? Maybe he brings in the animals he kills in dragon form here and roasts them." He felt a little sick at that. The white dragon, though, licked its lips as it imagined hot deer blood in its mouth, or maybe some beef. The spirit actually looked towards the other balcony on the far side of the room and yearned to stretch its wings and go hunting. Sweat coated Caden's upper lip. To shift voluntarily? Could he do that? Did he wish to? And then the white dragon spirit showed him an image of them soaring in the sky, then catching sight of a deer racing through the trees. They banked down with wings tucked back and would shoot like an arrow down to capture the deer in their strong jaws. Then they would tilt their head back and swallow it down whole. "He's going to order us some food," Caden told Iolaire. I think he'd totally freak out if we shifted. You agree, right? And I'm totally freaked at the idea of eating raw venison." The white dragon spirit let out a sigh and rested its head on its front claws, but its eyes were alight with curiosity. Those eyes followed Valerius, who was securing the large doors behind them, as if he too worried the president would try to get inside, or maybe one of the other politicians would make an unwanted appearance. Caden quickly looked away as Valerius turned around. Just past the fire pit, there was a large mahogany table with a throne-like seat at each end and rather magnificent chairs in between. On top of the table was a large silver bowl, heaped full of fruit. Caden's mouth automatically began to water, and he went over to it, hand poised above the biggest, brightest apple he'd ever seen. "Can I?" Caden asked as Valerius passed by him towards the balcony that looked out at the valley beyond. The Dragon King grunted in response, so Caden grabbed the apple with both hands and bit into it. He let out a moan of pleasure. It was crisp, sweet, and juicy. Clear juice ran down his chin, and he laughed. He used his fingers to clean it up and then licked them clean with gusto. He devoured the apple in what seemed like moments. Then he was reaching for a bunch of purple grapes. He started to stuff those into his mouth until his cheeks hurt from being stretched too wide. He chewed them for long moments. Grape juice burst on his tongue and flowed down his throat. Nothing had ever tasted so good. The stem of grapes was quickly picked clean, and he was peeling an orange in seconds flat. Valerius just had time to go to the balcony, stare out for a moment, and then turn back to look at what he was doing before he'd eaten the orange as well. "I will order you food now, or I fear you will start eating the table once the fruit is gone," the Dragon King said and came back inside. Valerius picked up a tablet that had been left sitting on a table near the balcony doors. He tapped a few commands into it, and set it down again. Caden was too busy peeling a banana to be curious about what he was ordering. In between bites of orange and banana, he looked around some more. Valerius had left the stone mostly exposed in his rooms. It was a whitish-gray color, smooth in places and glassy in others, as if exposed to high heat. There were a few spectacular tapestries on certain walls. They showed scenes of hunting with a dragon being the predator. They looked old but well cared for. None were moth-eaten or faded, but there was something about them that told Caden that they had likely once hung in a much older castle. There were bookcases that were stuffed full of paper books and old scrolls, too. From the look of them, Valerius was a reader. All of them appeared well-thumbed, and there were many books piled by chairs. There were shelves also full of wine, dark bottles with red wax caps that looked like they'd been there for hundreds of years. But there was no dust on them. Valerius, in fact, walked over and grabbed one of those bottles. He immediately uncorked it. He did not pour it into a glass, though, but instead took a large swig from the bottle itself. Feeling a little puckish, Caden asked, can I have a bottle too, since you don't look inclined to share? Valerius's eyes narrowed at him as he continued to drink the red wine, but he did not respond, and he did not offer Caden a drink. Caden shrugged and went back to eating yet another orange. This one was a blood orange, and it tasted sweet and tart and perfect. He wondered if the Dragon King got better food than the rest of them did. Or was the food somehow magical, because the fruit tasted great? Or it could have been since he was simply starving. Whatever the cause, though, he knew he was going to eat the entire silver bowl of fruit if he didn't stop himself. "Your spirit needs meat, not fruit. You'd best stop or you'll get sick," Valerius said tersely. Caden would have been touched by the concern, but he was pretty sure Valerius was only concerned about Caden vomiting on his furniture rather than his own well-being. But he swallowed the last slice of orange and wiped his hands on the front of his dirty secondhand jeans. He then stuffed them into his pockets and walked over to Valerius, who was back on the balcony, staring out into the night. Caden stood a few feet behind the Dragon King. It was peaceful here. He couldn't hear the traffic of Reach. There were no voices or laughter from the politicians and their aides. There was only the whistle of the breeze and the faint sound of nighthawks circling overhead. That and the splash of wine as Valerius drained the bottle. "What do you want, Caden?" Valerius asked suddenly. Caden's eyebrows lifted. "Hopefully whatever you ordered from the kitchen. I know I shouldn't spoil my appetite for this feast, but I'm really starving." Valerius spun to face him, eyes blazing. "Now is not the time for jokes. Be honest. What do you want?" "I've told you. My old life back," Caden said with a mulish set to his jaw. Wasn't Valerius listening to him? How many times and how many ways did he have to say it? It was pretty damned clear. "So you intend to remain in Reach? You're asking for my capital city as your own?" Valerius growled, and Caden saw flames in those dark eyes. Yes? Valerius lunged for him. His hands grasped Caden's shoulders and closed painfully. "You will not take my city." "What? No, 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 no. What are you on about?" Caden's hands rose up as he was waving them frantically. "That's not what I'm asking for. What would I do with a city? I just meant I wanted to live here, just like I do now with my parents." Valerius pulled Caden towards him. Their faces were inches from one another. They were breathing each other's breaths. "I do not understand you. Is this some game you are playing? But if it is, what do you hope to win?" Caden's spirit had gone very still, but was making a soft, purring sound low in the back of its throat.
"We should not be liking this. He's an asshole," Caden told the spirit. "I'm not playing any game, Valerius. I don't want to rule anything, and you need to stop touching me without permission," Caden cried.
Valerius flushed, then paled, but he did not let Caden go.
"I need to know the truth."
"That is the truth." Caden put his hands on Valerius's chest and pushed, but he was no match for the Dragon King's strength. It was like pushing against a brick wall.
"It can't be," Valerius shouted.
"Do not fight. It will make him fight. Be kind, gentle. He will not hurt us," the spirit said, or so it seemed to Caden. The words rose up in his mind like thought balloons.
"Why?"
Caden stopped pushing. He went almost limp. His hands, though, gripped the front of Valerius's armors.
"Why can't it be?" You're a dragon shifter,
Valerius breathed.
I'm me,
Caden answered. Valerius' grip loosened, but Caden did not jerk away. He stayed very still.
We are not a threat. We are not a threat to him because we do not wish to be,
the spirit said in Caden's mind.
I wasn't kidding when I told you. I didn't want anyone to know that I'm the white dragon shifter. If people know, then my life will change, and I don't want that,
Caden told Valerius. Even he wasn't so naive as to think that people wouldn't seek to use him in some kind of power struggle. Marban had already made that quite clear. In fact, Caden already might be indebted to the crime lord. He swallowed, miserable.
Maybe other people go through this kind of great transformation when they bond with their spirit, but I feel the same as I've always felt. I don't want to do anything different. Things are different, Caden. There's no going back to the way things were. You must go forward,
Valerius whispered.
I don't know how to do that. I can't do that, not on my own.
The last had not been something he had intended to say, but it was out there now. I hope you are enjoying Dragon's Reign so far. If you enjoy the fantasy aspect of Dragon's Reign, you might enjoy my high fantasy serial, The Elven King's Blade. The fantasy spans between our modern human world and a magical one where elves and other immortal beings are real. Elven King Athedin and modern human Kirin are unknowingly bonded across realms, but unless they complete the bond, they will die. Discovering his blade is human is impossible for Athedin to accept. For Kirin's part, accepting his fate is to save an elven kingdom is just as hard to take. If you want to check out The Elven King's Blade, the first 5 chapters are free to read. A link in the description is down below. Valerius breathed. His breath smelled of rich red wine, his body of leather and spice. Caden almost felt dizzy for a moment with the sheer scent and nearness of him. The Dragon King's eyes were pure black in that moment. His plush lips were parted. For the first time, Valerius looked real to him and so very there. Caden reached up and slowly drew his fingers along the bearded jaw.
I've only ever seen you flying and on the net.
Never, never so close. Never so real, Caden whispered.
I am real. I just do not know how you can be.
Valerius' hands on his shoulders were butterfly light. His fingers moved softly over Caden's skin. The white dragon spirit twittered softly, looking up at Valerius. He knew that Valerius saw it as his eyes focused as if looking inside of Caden. The Dragon King blinked and then pulled away. The loss of his touch had Caden instantly unsteady on his feet. He staggered forward but caught himself. The white dragon spirit whittered softly.
Valerius stalked back into the tower and over to the wine rack. He dragged out another bottle of wine, and this time he didn't even use a corkscrew to open it, but simply smashed the neck open and began to pour it down his throat.
Caden turned towards him. Sweat dotted his brow, and he felt lightheaded still.
Should you be doing that when you have to meet with a bunch of politicians later? I think you need to be at your best when you're speaking with the President of the United States.
She seemed pretty intent on talking out things with you, Caden said, even as he struggled to get a hold of himself.
That earned him a flare and nothing more. Valerius finished the bottle and then threw it into the flaming logs.
It shattered, and Caden jumped.
Cut it out! He was surprised that he could say such a thing to the Dragon King,
but he had not been lying when he told Valerius earlier that he was no longer afraid of him. The white dragon spirit made a soft, sad sound.
Stop it, Valerius. Stop. Please. And what would you have me do? Valerius shouted, his arms flying up into the air. You are impossible. You claim to want nothing. And I might actually believe you, but that makes you an innocent, and that makes all of this impossible.
Impossible? Caden thought. Yeah. I sort of feel the exact same thing, but I'm here.
So, you asked me what I want. Caden moved towards the Dragon King. What about what you want? The Dragon King, who had been standing there, staring at him in silence for long moments, let out a harsh laugh.
For this day to have not happened, or for it to have started over so they could make other choices.
You're thinking of those people who died in the below.
Of course, I can forget them.
Or rather, I can, but I will not. Valerius scowled into the fire.
So many have died by my hand. Those today are nothing.
They aren't nothing, so don't pretend you don't care, Caden shouted, his hands fisted at his sides. He was suddenly shaking his head.
I shouldn't have led you there. I was just so scared, and you had the right to be scared.
Valerius sat down heavily on one of the couches by the fire, his large yet elegant hands dug into his thick, dark locks. And he sat there, the firelight playing over his golden skin. Caden sat down on the couch opposite him. The fire sizzled and crackled between them like a living thing.
If I go back to my life, then all this, all the impossibilities are gone. The white dragon shifter is gone, and you get to have things as they were. You cannot be so foolish as to think that you can simply disappear. Everyone saw you. They know you exist. They will be looking for you.
A trickle of unease went through Caden.
Who will be looking for me exactly? The other dragons?
Valerius nodded.
Among others, your very existence is threatening the current order. Even if I were to believe that you don't wish to rule anything, the others will not. They will want you taken care of.
Caden gulped as his right hand rose to his throat.
Taken care of? You mean killed?
That is one option. Or they will wish you to be on their side, Valerius explained.
Two dragons in one territory, if you really are willing to be subordinate, would make a far greater foe than simply one, though it is unheard of for two dragons to actually fight together.
I'll fight with you, Caden sat up straighter.
You saw that I'm not completely useless in a fight. The ice thing was pretty cool, wasn't it?
Yes, Valerius said dryly. Probably not a good idea to bring up the ice thing, right? Caden cleared his throat.
No, it is not.
There appeared to be a small smile on Valerius's lips, but it was hard to say. It was so very faint and gone so very quickly. Caden shifted so that his elbows were on his knees. The fire's warmth seemed to caress his face.
Why does Raziel hate me? Is it just a territorial thing? Because it seemed like it was more. I mean, he totally took over from you and you must never speak of that to anyone.
Valerius interrupted him. There was almost a look of fear in his eyes, and Caden doubted that the Dragon King ever felt fear. So this must be really serious.
What happened with Raziel has not occurred in millennia, and it will never occur again. You need to understand what would happen if people thought we could not control our spirits. Already the humans think of shifters as little better than wild animals. They respect us only because they fear us, but it is a certain kind of fear. They believe they know the rules. If they were to learn that the rules were not as... I get it. I won't tell anyone, Caden said.
Valerius stared at him hard, and Caden shifted uncomfortably, but he did not look away. He would keep his promise. Finally, the Dragon King seemed to relax and slumped back against the sofa.
What are we going to do with you, Caden? Valerius asked.
I hope that's like a rhetorical question, because I don't think anything needs to be done with me, Caden said.
There you go again, to believing that things have not changed completely for you.
Valerius scrubbed his face with both hands.
You wish to stay here, but I cannot allow that.
Both Caden and the white dragon spirit stiffened.
Why not? Why can't I stay? Raziel, I cannot risk another episode with it, and you bring those out, Valerius said.
Caden's heart beat like a hummingbird inside his chest, desperate to get out.
Where else would I go? Another city? Another country? Another territory? There's no way. I'm not leaving. So you got to get it together with Raziel. Make it understand that things are as they are and I'm here to stay and it's got to deal with it.
Valerius's eyebrows rose with every word Caden said.
You saw Raziel. Does it look like anyone tells it what to do?
You're the Dragon King, Valerius. Are you telling me that you are not in charge? Caden did not look away from Valerius's eyes.
I am.
Really? Because what you just said, I am, Valerius blazed at him.
Good.
The white dragon spirit murped in agreement. Caden slumped back himself against the opposite couch. You better be the one that can tell it what to do. I'm betting Raziel might not care about those people who died today, but you do. The world needs the person who cares about those who died running things. You have to control your spirit. Valerius's eyebrows rose.
You are very bold to say such a thing. You've had your spirit for less than 12 hours, and you are telling me how to deal with mine?
Yeah, I am. You know it's the only way. Caden shook his head.
What I know is that I have a selfish, spoiled child that does not want to leave his home for the greater good, Valerius said grimly.
Was that it? Was he being selfish and spoiled? Or was he just being afraid?
But the white dragon spirit narrowed its eyes at Valerius and lowered its head, making what sounded suspiciously like a growling sound. It did not want to go.
We belong here. We are not leaving, it said.
My spirit says no. I'm not being selfish. We're here to stay and that's that, Caden told him.
He saw Valerius through the flames. The Dragon King appeared as if he was wreathed in fire.
A being of pure heat.
Caden was not afraid, but he was impressed.
You do not know what you were taking on, little dragon, by seeking to stay here, Valerius hissed softly.
No, maybe not, Caden swallowed.
But I know it's right. I am supposed to be here.
What proceeded next was a stare down. But Caden had lots of experience at this with his sister. But he didn't have long to face the Dragon King because there was a knock on the door.
What?
Valerius snapped.
It's Yoni, the voice answered.
Caden's parents are here. I hope you enjoyed this week's chapter. If you want to read ahead in Dragon's Reign or read the many other stories hosted there, you can purchase a membership to get access to WraithRain.com. Or you can continue to listen along here for free. If you'd like to learn more about WraithRain.com and me, there's a link in the description down below.